reading a blog about the evils of corporate America.
Oh, so true. Is that the new iPhone?
Yeah, it's incredible.
We should go to college.
Yeah, let's wait till Bernie makes it free.
Wait, if everything in Portland is weird, isn't weird normal?
48 minutes of dogs barking, 48 minutes of dogs barking, 48 minutes of dogs barking, 48 minutes of dogs barking. Growl. Growl. 48 minutes of dogs barking, 48 minutes of dogs barking.
God, life's, I mean, like, I was, like, actually, like, thinking in the car on the way here, I'm just like, life is, like, life is shit. I'm just not happy right now. There's, like, a handful of things that, like, really bring me joy, and one of them is doing this podcast, and the other one is sometimes, like, putting on booty shorts and, like, Angel Olsen and, like, making dinner for my girlfriend to, like, sad country, Appalachian country music.
I love it.
You know, when you got gams like these, it's a shame.
Yeah,
not
I was
going to
say, yeah, don't hide your light under a bushel there, buddy. I got some upsetting news this week, Bryan.
What's up?
Jordan Peterson doxxed me at my place of work. You know, you and I have talked about, and I work at the Dick Sucking Factory LLC. Well, apparently...
that footage of you testing out the new model.
That's right. Yeah, he tweets there, such fun and unbelievable techno nightmare CCP hell. Well, he doesn't realize that the Dick Sucking Factory LLC is actually based in, you know, Olivet, but but here's the footage.
It almost got taken down by the Costco development right there at 70.
Almost. But yeah, it's a bunch of guys in a hospital type environment having their dinks sunked on by machines.
yeah, it's pretty wild.
Sorry, this is on a
there
loop,
are amazing like, things happening in China.
They are on the threshold of the future. Yeah, so apparently he did post that for real because the confirmation came from Michaela Peterson, his daughter, who responded, "Dad, you can't retweet this on Twitter. My eyes will never recover."
Well, wasn't she the one that like shipped her father off to Russia to get some weird experimental treatment that put him
to
in
get
a coma?
Him off benzos? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Just a yeah. It was Mom, it was actually... at console man who saved the footage and just posted incredible.
Yeah, I think that broke everyone's brains because I saw someone I follow on Twitter. Say that I really do not need to see any more Jordan Peterson stuff.
Yeah.
At this point, it's no longer funny. It's just sad. And yeah. I'm like, no, it's still funny.
No, it's very funny. It's very funny that he's probably in a K-hole or something just posting whatever.
He's in his goon. He's gooning. he's like gooning, but for like return stuff.
Yeah.
Oh, Ecto Cooler. Gary Coleman. I don't know why I'm making my Jordan Peterson sound like Mickey Mouse.
Yeah.
Look what they're doing in the hellscape in the CCP.
Why would he automatically assume that it's some Chinese thing? I don't know. But yeah, just...
Because the penises weren't very big.
I mean, they were average size, but the guys are kind of overweight, so it was a 50-50.
I used to work with a guy who sounded like Mickey Mouse.
Oh, no.
But he was like an older dude with man tits that drove a truck. Oh. And I remember he hated one of the managers so much. And one of the college kids we had one summer was like telling me, like, yeah, I was in the truck with him. And we saw such and such walking across the street. And he just goes, that guy's a fucking joke. That guy right there, he's a fucking joke. And I was like, no, you didn't do the right voice. And in front of everyone's going, that guy right there, he's a fucking joke. The fucking joke. And everyone lost their fucking mind. And like, he would come out and be like really frustrated with something. He goes, those motherfuckers, they haven't given me a raise in 10 years. I worked so hard for these people. Pieces of shit.
Yeah, just, oh man. That sounds like a hoot, man.
All they're doing in there is counting their money and thinking about how they're going to fuck me over.
Well, you need to unionize, Mickey. That's all I'm going to tell you about that. So, an interesting piece of footage was released this week. Miami-Dade state attorney drops charges against a man who fired 11 times in a...
They dropped the charges?
Yeah, in a 2021 road rage incident.
I remember seeing this original video and like this guy has poor... Just for shooting wildly is doing a poor job at it.
Well, my favorite part is actually the opening. He's listening to some random techno song and he's doing the thing where you're just like making up lyrics and he's going, suck my dick, you fucking bitch. And then he sees this guy, he brake checks him, and then like he calmly opens the console, pulls out this little pistol, and then like hides it on his person, tucks it in, you know, close to him.
Yeah.
And then he just, without rolling down the windows, fires fucking 11 rounds, just this right here, this video, and he's wincing and blink and like closing his eyes. He wasn't planning on hitting anything. Just really fucking weird.
So why they drop charges?
I have no idea. That part is really baffling to me, but the footage came up again, and it really, I immediately thought, like, somebody gave Stavi Baby a gun. He's going, suck my dick, to the techno music.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
What a fun thing to have come up on your feed at random. This guy just blind firing, like literally he's closing his eyes and wincing as he's blind firing.
Yeah,
from
it's
his
not,
passenger side to
it's
the
not
front.
Even like he's like leading or anything.
No,
it's just like it's
he's one-handed because he's got his other hand on the wheel. He's just pop 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 pop. What a fucking asshole. Just like, really, you brake check the guy and then you're gonna pop a fucking 11 shots
I
at
mean
him?
Here's the thing is like usually what I like to do is brake check someone in the leftmost lane.
Right.
And it's always a guy in a Beamer.
Oh, always.
But the best part to do is when you get in the lane to your right, you get a semi.
Yeah.
He's got nowhere to go.
Yeah.
Yeah, look at me and my... Look, suck my dick. I'm in my busted-ass fucking Toyota. And, like, you got nowhere to go, Mr. fucking 5 Series.
Yeah, well, that 5 Series guy might fucking open up on you, so you got to watch yourself if Miami is
Yeah, well... I'm not on. That usually doesn't happen on 70.
Yeah, well, things
that seems to be where. Jeez, we're getting into real some like local.
Yeah.
Some local culture here, but like Highway 70, I think when you hear about someone like just randomly firing at another car, is usually Highway 70 for some reason.
Yeah, that is true. It's just I don't know what it is about that place.
But... I mean, Highway 70 also kind of. I mean, that's why I don't have a gun. I think Highway 70 has definitely brought out some.
I can see it. Yeah, I can definitely see if I had a little 22 in the dash, I'd be like, "Hey, what's up?" I get it, is what I'm saying. But I also
your Joy 91 FM sticker is just a target for me.
Another weird bit of lore from the internet. Apparently, yeah. There are a number of sites ripping off the porn dude. Right? Are you familiar with the porn dude?
Unfortunately, I am.
Yeah.
I'm a man of wealth and taste.
Exactly. So, user at @XXX_red, it makes sense, just posted this series of images, and it's all these anime or animated avatars.
They look like the son from American Dad.
Some of them do, yeah. Yeah, some of them look like, some of them look like Seth Green went to a caricaturist. Yeah. You know, so.
Are you familiar with the porn dude is?
I know what the porn dude is. Yeah, it's like an aggregator, right?
Well, what I know of, maybe I'm thinking of something else, but it is a guy with the fucking head on, like a fucking mascot head.
Oh, that's right. Okay.
It's really upsetting.
Bryan is right. There is a video series of the porn dude. It's a guy with like a mascot head, and he goes and shoots a scene with a girl.
It's one of those things where like I don't think we need this. I think we need more pee. I think we need more pee on the internet.
Well, so there's other sites that are aggregators. The Porn Geek, Mr. Porn Geek, Porn Dork. pornmemo.com, Bachelor Blog, Best List of Porn, Porn Guide, Porn List Dude, Dude Thrill. Dude Thrill's icon is my favorite because it looks like he's a swanky bartender polishing an eggplant. Hey, what are you having? Oh, a dick. All right. Jerk Dude, Find Best Porno, Porn Video List, and FindBear.com. Now, that kid in the FindBear.com icon.
Oh, no. Oh, no. He looks like one of the JNCO kids.
Yeah.
You remember that? You remember the JNCO cartoon characters?
Right. It does eerily similar.
That is very upsetting.
So, apparently, there's an entire lore involved with this. For example, the porn dude has a rivalry with the porn geek to the point where the porn dude created an unflattering fat imposter version of him. Porngeek.com. Not Mr. Porn Geek. Mr. Porn Geek is what appears to be a very angry Asian man grasping at air, looking at his iPad. But Porn Geek, on the other hand, is essentially a South Park caricature of the fedora-wearing a horn dog. Just the porn dude, porn geek, my gay porn sites, my gay sites, does appear to be the same artist. So, completely apropos of nothing, I saw this image and was like, this is really weird. These are...
And I heard that capitalism bred innovation.
Hmm.
But this seems to prove the opposite.
Mm-hmm. Mm, yeah. Apparently, porn dude-like guys have an entire...
porn webmasters.
So apparently...
We're really getting into like the golden age of jacking it.
Oh, yeah, yeah. These guys, they're like... they got... This is the porn version of like a web ring. You know,
when you go onto the website, it plays like a 15-second MIDI of the South Park theme.
Yeah. Yeah, that does what it, I mean, it's an island and there's like porn webmasters there. There's an inflatable doll. And it was so bizarre. I had to make mention of it.
The horn dude. Oh, porn dude. I like horn dude better. I'm disappointed.
I do too. So, yeah, the courtesy of Mega the Vile on Twitter, finding out from old screenshots that the porn dude used to be drawn as a nerd. Then that Mr. Porn Geek guy came along and made a site similar to him. So the porn dude started drawing his mascot as a buff Chad in retaliation. The first reply is, maybe he hit the gym, got on the grind set. You know, I'm still the porn dude, but, you know, I can squat 250 or whatever, you know, whatever he's going to say. Ah, yes. Here's another bit of news. Joe Rogan, our mutual friend.
Yeah.
Somebody, friend of the pod, Joe Rogan.
I think the Tall Bart Joe Rogan podcast AI videos are some of my favorite things in the world. I feel like I've sent you a couple dozen.
Yeah, yeah.
Check, check, check. 1, 2, check, check, checking.
Check.
Does it sound good?
Check,
check, check, check.
Check. One,
are we
two,
ready
check
to go? Check.
How are
check
my levels?
Check.
Oh my
one,
fucking
two,
god!
Check.
It sounds
one,
fine. Can we move on?
We're checking the levels, Jordan.
Yeah, Jordy. Learn a little patience.
Learn a little patience, Jordan.
I hate this new dynamic. Why do I have to be the reasonable one?
More like, why do you have to be the little bitch one?
Home run, Joe.
That was off the dome.
All right.
Got his dickless ass.
Hey, are you kids recording?
Yeah. What's up?
How are my levels?
Fine. You sound fine. What do you want,
Jordan?
What?
I got one.
Oh no.
Bencoin's gone to the fucking moon. You guys seen this shit?
For technical and liability reasons, it's Bencoin 2.0.
Who fucking cares what it's called? You're fucking rich.
Maybe on paper, I'm not cashing out.
What? Why not? Kid, you're a millionaire.
I'm going down with the ship.
Jordan, would you rather suck a donkey's balls for 10 minutes or work one night in a soup kitchen serving your fellow man?
It's one of the few things I'm really enjoying right now. Like, yeah. There's a new one. My poor girlfriend will be like sitting on the couch and I'll be like, a new one dropped. And... I have to make her watch it.
She's got to sit through it, yeah.
Yeah, because I'm just a great partner. Like, yeah. Hey, here's this thing I think you find mildly annoying, and you're too comfortable to get up and go to the other room.
I do that to my wife all the time. I'm like, hey, babe, check this out. They'll play something. She goes, cool. And looks back at her. Completely disinterested. It's fine. You know, like, we have different interests. You know, like, she went and did gardening like all day the other day. I was like, this
oh, man,
what you want to do,
right.
I guess. But Joe Rogan in the news.
Back to the original.
No, it relates. Joe Rogan officially opened the doors of his anti-woke comedy club in Austin, Texas.
Wow.
Yeah.
So brave.
The Ritz Theater off 6th Street in Austin. Opening night did not disappoint, according to Newsmax. You got to just put that out there. It's Newsmax. Opening night Tuesday did not disappoint, with a lineup featuring several canceled comedians, including David Lucas, Ron White, Tom Dillon, Tony Hinchcliffe, and Roseanne Barr.
Sure wasn't Tim Dillon?
Tim Dillon. Did I say Tom Dillon?
You said Tom Dillon.
Tom Dillon. I was reading.
Tom Dillon sounds like a really bad mustard.
Yeah, it does. No, I was reading Tony Hinchcliffe, and I guess I fucked that up. All right.
You're fine.
I'm drunk and on mushrooms in my new club. This is as high as I've ever been on stage, Rogan said, as he took the stage Tuesday night. So apparently he was emceeing and introducing all the acts at his club. The outlet in question, New York Post, cited that Rogan as saying he aimed to create a safe space for comedians to share their humor without a fear of being canceled. You can't fire me from my own club, bitch, he said.
I think a really great bit, if you were like a comedian that's quote unquote canceled and you were like performing there, is just like walk up on stage with like the Friars Club, like 1984, like roast joke book. And just be like, all right, we're moving over to Jewish American princesses.
Roseanne Barr, by the way, called it a mothership for comedians. Quote, it's so great to be in the green room with everybody up there being drunk and smoking pot, which of course is Rogan's club. Of course he's good.
Yeah, you guys ever done DMT and said the N-word?
Apparently Roseanne has.
Jamie, give us that list of slurs from Wikipedia.
Are they alphabetical? Sorted by alphabetical, Jamie.
But did you hear the rules of his club?
I did not catch that. No.
It has been reported. Mm-hmm. I have not had this backed up in a more legitimate way. But that when you enter, they scan your face, and then you have to put your phone in a Faraday box.
No.
And you can't record anything, and if you like you heckle or anything like that, you're banned for life.
What?
Yeah.
That's even stupider.
So, again, like the whole like anti-cancel culture thing sure sounds like the thing it's trying to like not be.
Yeah. Holy shit. Oh, Jesus. You got to put your phone in a Faraday cage. You can't take
any videos or anything like that.
No.
There's like no recording.
Right, because you and don't want like, the guys to get canceled again.
Yeah.
You don't want Roseanne to start yelling the
N-word. God forbid Tim Dillon talks about how he wish he had gotten molested as a kid again.
Again, yeah, that's what.
Well, no, not that telling like a story about it again. Not that he got molested as a child.
I understood what you meant.
I think for him it was a sore spot that he was not molested when he was a young, hot, fuckable child. In his words.
I have to sit with that one. I don't even remember that. Jesus Christ.
It was on when he was on Cumtown.
Okay. That makes a lot of sense. Yeah. It seems to be the kind of joke he would make when surrounded by those guys.
One of those episodes is the one that gave us Pierre St. Pierre.
Oh.
Well, how are they going to know about it, Sarge, but don't tell them? Listening to that on the way to New Orleans to go see Stav perform in New Orleans.
Fantastic.
Choice. Deep fried gasoline.
Well, I'm headed to New Orleans this Friday, so that's
yes, maybe I'm apparently heading there some point this year with
Wonderful.
My girlfriend. So
Wonderful.
I'm excited. I love New Orleans.
A Twitter user at DJ Ben Hameen, who goes by Big DJ Energy. Has anyone ever admitted to themselves that John Wick is a complete psychopath and the main villain of the series? We talked on the show before about...
I've never seen the John Wick movie, so...
Okay.
Well, I know he holds the gun in that cool way. Like to the side.
Yeah.
And they killed his dog.
Yep. That's pretty much all you need to know about the movie. He's a former assassin for hire.
Mm-hmm.
He retired to be with his wife. The wife died. He's alone in his house. A Russian gangster's kid tries to steal his car, and he says no. He steals the car anyway, kills the dog. It's a whole thing. So he sets out on a quest for revenge, right?
Yeah.
But it's... We're now approaching a fourth...
You killed my dog.
Keanu Reeves has gotten so much better with age, like at actual acting, that I think like, yeah, okay, that's who it is, but he's better than that. But yeah, it's
Dracula.
Whoa, Dracula. It's hard.
That movie is so interesting and captivating, but every single time he's on screen, it's just like, what?
Well, considering who he's playing against most of the time,
yeah,
Gary fucking Oldman,
just everyone. Everyone he's outclassed by everyone in that film.
Anthony Hopkins, like you that's not fair. You can't put.
Wow,
that guy
whoa,
up against
the lady doth protest too much.
Right. Anyway, the point of this post is that this person, you know, I've talked about media literacy not being a thing in the United States, and apparently this person also does not understand that just because a character is the main character of a movie, it does not mean that they're a good person.
Yeah.
So John Wick is a psychopath. I'm like, well, he's an assassin. Let's start there. A former assassin.
Folks, he kills people for money.
Right.
He's not giving candy to homeless kids.
And even if he was. Another movie-related thing did crop up this week. A R-rated trailer for the upcoming sex comedy No Hard Feelings. Have you seen this, Bryan?
I haven't.
Okay, so I'm going to play it for you briefly.
Grow up!
The kid is unfuckable.
Have a drink together.
He'll have a Long Island iced tea.
This is the worst iced tea I've ever had.
Okay, you know what?
Raunchy sex comedies. I love them, and I love that
they're coming back. I feel like we haven't had a good one in a while.
I think the last good one I saw was probably Cock Blockers, which has been a while. It was John Cena in that.
John's, are you, I'm here to block the cocks.
Yeah, that one and the to-do list are the last two sex comedies I really remember.
Yeah, I mean, that looks like it has some legs.
And the fact that Jennifer Lawrence is kind of branching out into, like, you know, nasty comedy, I'm like,
she
cool.
She gave us the phrase science oven, so, like, I don't That's, feel like...
Yeah. I guess it's not that far-fetched, I suppose, but, like... But then it struck me. It's like, oh, wait. Wasn't there a thing...
Oh, did we fall for viral marketing, Jason?
Yeah, we did. We absolutely did. Yeah, there was a bit of...
I remember this going around, and I go, I don't care. I don't give a shit. I'm not clicking this.
No, it was...
I don't care if it's the secret of immortality spelled out in this article. I'll just throw me in the fucking dirt with the rest of them.
Yeah, so it was a fake ad about date my son for a car that turned out to be a bit of viral marketing for this movie.
Jeez. It's like that Nine Inch Nails record.
Oh, except it's a sex movie. I don't know. It's just... that, to me, was like, why do you even need to do that?
That feels very, like, 2005, like, yeah. MySpace ad thing.
Try hard shit. Like, it's Jennifer Lawrence in a sex comedy. I'm going to see that on day one. Are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah.
She's funny.
I'm going to be jelking in my seat.
That's not what I was saying, but all right. I mean, you know, like...
Absolutely, just knowing all the people in front of me, because I just won't stop shooting white hot ropes over their heads.
Okay.
Getting into their popcorn. And they're like, oh, this popcorn is a little bit more salty than usual.
This is why I don't go to the movies with you.
Put a little... Give me about 3 minutes, no. And I'll make your popcorn taste even better, Jason.
Oh, baby. That's the 48 minutes of dogs barking riff of the week.
Yeah, anyway. I suddenly have nothing to say. Isn't that
funny? You know what's a fun thing to do?
What's that?
Walk into a room and go, what smells like cum?
Oh, fuck. And then you go, oh, it's me.
You know, you should wash your dick before you pull your pants back.
That is true. That's you know what? That's advice everyone could live by.
Yeah.
So that, I don't know, that struck me as particularly funny because, like, there's no need to guerrilla market that. That's pretty marketable on its own.
I feel like that kind of sells itself.
Yeah. I think it's about time that we talk about, I got a twofer tonight.
A twofer?
Crypto scams of the week.
You're listening to 48 Minutes of Dogs Barking, the podcast.
And now it's time for the crypto scam of the week.
What you got for me, crypto scam daddy?
We have the one that you brought to me.
The Euler?
Kyber. Swap. So
everything. I mean, everything's getting fucking exploited right now. I can't
even... That's true.
Fucking keep track of it.
First and foremost is going to be Kyberswap. Kyberswap is a I don't really even know what it is. What is it, like a marketplace? What is it, like a clearinghouse? What do they? What exactly do they do?
How I am made to understand, it's kind of like 1inch, where it aggregates all the different liquidity pools among, I believe, different DEXs.
Okay.
So like it would be like Uniswap and like, you know, Shiba Swap and like, I'm trying to think what else is. I'm trying to think of anything comparable, but like, so it goes and sees what gets you the best rate of return for what your exchange. It gives you the best exchange rate. And so in this instance, when USDC, which I don't think has ever depegged before, lost its peg, someone tried, was it selling $2 million worth?
They were swapping that for another token. They were trying
to get out of
three CRV tokens priced at about 1.9 mil for stable coins using KyberSwap. This is courtesy of Web3 is going great. Yeah, that was their breakdown of it. Due to an apparent flaw in which the protocol routed the trade through a project with very little liquidity, the trade suffered from massive slippage and was front-run by an MEV bot. An MEV bot made off with a nice $34,000, and the trader wound up with only 5 cents in the Tether stablecoin.
Yeah, you know what? We make fun of crypto shit all the time, but God, that's a real kick in the nuts.
That's, somebody got really hosed.
That's fucking miserable. But also, when you go to, you know, say, okay, this you have to verify this trade is good.
Yeah.
You would have gotten visual confirmation, like, if you do this trade, you may only get 5 cents.
Right. That feels like, oh, it's a flaw in the protocol. No, it's kind of also a flaw in somebody not doing their diligence.
Yeah, you know what, well, I mean? Like, also, what a fucking knee-jerk reaction, because USDC is already, I think, refound its peg.
Right.
So, like,
this is, the timing sucked.
Yeah. Someone got fucking emotional in their trading.
Right.
And so they also still would have lost technically a ton of money going from, you know, well, they lost like a 4% difference, I guess.
Yeah.
To go from like 96 cents to a, you know, something that's supposed to be a, you know, one Tether equals $1 and all that stuff.
Right. And according to some of the Twitter comments, the issue is that the aggregator routed the trade through Uniswap instead of Curve, and Uniswap at the time had no liquidity. And so that was, so even if the transaction was private, the outcome would have been the same. It just, it was sloppy on all sides, essentially. And KyberSwap did reach out to the user, and they're trying to make them whole. So we're hoping that that doesn't stick. Like, 'cause boy, whew.
That's fucking miserable on so many levels.
It's just terrible.
But this is also what happens when you play in markets that have like no regulation. And some of this stuff is literally like code that sometimes like it's taken off Fiverr.
Right.
And like, you know, it's people like duct taping shit together, hoping that then they can get to a place where they actually can hire some real coders and make it legitimate.
Well, I mean, back in September, KyberSwap had a problem where somebody inserted malicious code into the front end. And it took off with a quarter mil of user funds.
Yeah.
So, I mean, just like their code's obviously not that great. And we've known that for a while now. You know? Like, it's just, it feels like at a certain point, you kind of walked right into it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you chose this swap, you know, this company to swap with. And
also, what size to be trading with?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Was it 2.8 million?
2.8 or 1.95 mil.
Yeah. Okay, 1.5. Yeah. Well, even then, like,
it's a lot. That's,
you know,
a lot.
You gotta average out. Like, if most projects, if you wanted to sell $2 million of a project, I mean, even Ethereum at once, like, you're gonna get some congestion. You're gonna find,
there's gonna be, yeah.
Yeah. You, for what, first of all, that person must have been losing their fucking mind to do something so stupid. Because if you wanted to get out of that position, you would have DCA'd, you would have averaged it out, you would have spaced it out.
Right.
Instead of just selling the whole fucking lump, because you have to have the volume to come back in,
right,
to replace your sell, and then you can taper yourself out.
Yeah, because I think the transaction they were looking to do was to replace whatever coin they had, this 3CRV, with a stable coin, USDC, like you said. But, like, it's a huge order. I mean, that's a lot.
I'm sorry, I'm getting confused. I thought they were trying to sell the USDC,
no,
and they got fucked.
No, they were trying to swap an existing coin
for
a stable coin. but it routed through a project that had no liquidity, and so they
lost everything.
They lost everything. So, yeah. But Kyber, like I said, has admitted that that was on their end, and they're trying to make them whole. So here's hoping, you know, knock wood, that person's made whole, because, boy, it seems like a pretty easy mistake to make.
Right. If you're not super experienced or you're trading emotionally, most of the time when I hear something like that, it's like a couple $100. Like
right.
Someone didn't realize that there was a bot or a sniper that was watching that project waiting for someone to come through.
Right.
And fuck up your shit.
There's definitely a lot of blame to go around, but I think, like I said, Kyber has pretty much owned up to the fact that it was on them.
Yeah, I mean...
So I wouldn't necessarily call that a scam, but it definitely falls into sketchy territory, you know what I mean? Like, it's it's one of those things. But we do have our second one. Definitely, it was a rug pull, and it has been called as such by CoinDesk. Arbitrum DEX ArbiSwap rug pulls users for over 100,000. So yeah, their native Arby tokens fell from $1.50 to a fraction of a cent.
That's
very,
wild,
very fast.
Because
yes.
I think Arby has been one of the big degenerate chains for this bear cycle.
Mm-hmm.
You know, BNB was 2021.
Mm-hmm.
People tried fucking around with Avalanche, had some success. Sol, but Sol keeps fucking not working.
Right.
So, you know, there's some diehards on there, and I'm sure some of them will get rich and others will lose their shirt. But most of the fucking degens or degenerates that I fucking track on Twitter and stuff like that, we're really big into that chain. And I think we're also really big into that swap. And like, huh, yeah, it doesn't seem to be working out.
So yeah, a little bit about ArbiSwap. They offered swapping of various cryptos for low fees on its platform, and their advertising included giving back 100% of all generated revenue to holders of Arby, which is their own coin. Rogue developers, according to CoinDesk, which I don't believe for a second, but rogue developers controlled the project's liquidity pools, and they literally pulled the rug, so they swapped. Yeah, blockchain data shows that the developers minted 1 billion fake tokens, swapping these for USDC and then for 69 ETH, which was the $100,000 price tag.
Nice.
On the top there. So, yeah, rogue developers. No, pretty sure that feels pretty it feels pretty intentional. I don't know. It's one of those things where, like, you never really can know for sure. And, of course, ArbiSwap has declined to comment. Because why would you?
Yeah, when you've already got your 100K, why would you?
Right. After investors had purchased the tokens in hope of a positive return, the developers closed shop, removed liquidity, and they are gone. So, yeah, we're not having hope there.
Man, that's a classic rug pull.
I mean, that is the textbook definition, if you really want to go there. Yeah, that's for later. Hold on. So, Bryan, I think it's time for our main topic tonight. I got a lot to say about this
website. I've
been
listening to Chill Wave all day.
Yes.
Getting excited for this topic. I've been wondering what it means to be authentic.
Oh, yeah.
And to be a meme. And I'm just really, you know, I was getting actually a little bit in my feels because I realized I was no longer living a life worth blogging about.
That's true. What Bryan and I are talking about today is, of course, Hipster Runoff, formerly abbreviated as HRO, run by the pseudonymous Carls. not Charles. Carls. That's right. 2007 is when that blog first came about. It only ran for about 5-6 years.
Yeah.
Well, no, I want to say, well, let me do my math here. It's probably seven years. I think 2014 is when
it
formally took a dive. But yeah, the wonderful stuff.
It's when I think that's when AmAppy stopped being trend.
AmAppy, that's American Apparel, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, I read Hipster Runoff for years, and every once in a while I'll still be like, who's Anco? Oh, yeah, Animal Collective, the band. Yeah, like,
we were kind of trying to figure out what to do this week, and you were like, oh, maybe we should do Hipster Runoff this time. And I was like, yeah, sure. And I started, like, thinking about it. I'm like, oh, Hipster Runoff is so illustrative of a very weird point of my life.
Well, and a very specific time on the internet too, like,
yeah,
the rise of Pitchfork and all those kind of, well, I mean, Carls themselves even said, you know, blog scene, like, there was a whole
genre.
Yeah,
I mean, this was Hipster Runoff came about the time where, like, people were getting like press passes to South By because they're like Google Analytics looked really good to press, you know, people that were the gate holders and stuff.
Oh yeah. Unlike other stuff that we've covered in previous episodes, there's a lot. Because Carl's was a prolific writer.
Yeah.
So there's a lot to cover there, but there's also been a lot of articles about hipster runoff in the intervening years. Motherboard, which is the Vice sub...
Vertical, I think, is the term that the VCs want you to use.
Okay. Sorry. It's the Vice Vertical. So yes, Carl's was hipster of the decade, by the way.
Yeah.
Hipster of the decade, courtesy of Gawker. With 32% of the vote, he smashed the runner-up Gavin McGinnis by a full 10%. And thank God that he did.
Amazing.
What do you think Gavin McGinnis would have done?
Try to put a dildo up his ass again?
I was going to say again? Yeah.
I'm not gay.
Yeah.
I just like it. It makes me feel tight.
Well, I mean, yeah, that's true. There have been some interesting articles. Hipster United did a investigative expose trying to dox Carl's, essentially. Carl's, their identity was never really known formally because they never really did one of those things like where Jeb Lund, for example, came out and was like, yeah.
I'm Mr. Destructo.
Exactly. And... yeah. There was never something like that. But
oh, gosh. You know, we should talk about Mr. Destructo sometime.
We will have to. Yes. Putting it on the list.
Oh, Tao Lin?
Stylistically, they claim Tao Lin blogs like Carl's talks/blogs. Compare the writing of the post on his blog with Carl's first post, you know, compare the paragraphs. Like, they're really going into that. Now, they don't have any definitive proof. They just say, you know, Talon and Carl's have an intensifying online relationship. New Yorker even, New York Magazine, excuse me, even went into this. Their article headline, Tao Lin is maybe, probably not, the hipster runoff guy. So nobody really knows, you know?
You know, in a way, it was kind of a spiritual successor to what, like, Buddyhead was doing with...
Oh, for sure,
with,
yeah.
Like, the gossip page. And it was also really weird, because, like, I think the real heyday of hipster runoff was definitely, like, 2009, like, 2012 or 2013.
Yeah.
And it was really weird reading hipster runoff and then being like, oh, that person is playing the Firebird tomorrow. Or like, you know, I remember Toru Waimoi, you know, the whole chill wave thing and like, you know, his obsession with Kickball Katie from Vivian Girls. And like, you know, and I'm watching Kickball Katie trying to like not, I really hate to say this, but not cry because like the shitty fucking county kids that came to that Black Lips show were like fucking just being really mean to the Vivian Girls and they put on a fantastic set.
Yeah.
And they did not deserve that. And they deserve all the love in the world. And I have a signed poster of them in my little apartment. You know, I don't know where I'm really going with this, but it was like really interesting to be like, oh, the one that always sticks with me is the fucking MA31 where he just repeats City is my church like a fucking million times.
Because that's how it is on the
Knowing that MA3 had to reroute the entire tour behind that record in the US just to avoid playing the Firebird because that record went fucking white hot. Yeah. They rerouted the whole fucking tour so that MA3 would be at the Pageant, which is a 2300 cap, instead of the Firebird, which is like a 450 cap if you don't care about fire regulations.
Hey-o. Hipster runoff always, to me, was like, oh, this is fucking clickbait. And it's also satirizing that same scene while also being part of it. It was it rode the line a lot. Like, there was a lot of that stuff where it was like, are you fucking with me? Or do you really believe that, like, Animal Collective was a band created for/by the internet? Okay. Like, Animal Collective, in my opinion, isn't all that great.
No.
I never understood the appeal.
No. I remember I had a friend named Brandon, a high school friend, and he was really obsessed with fucking Animal Collective. I remember him playing me Animal Collective on a burnt CD that I had to play on my Discman in my fucking A8 Camry, which was my first car, in the fucking parking lot of the Mills Mall.
Oof.
And just being like, this is okay.
Yeah.
This is okay. I don't know.
They're the most okayest band I've heard. Yeah.
Yeah, and he would, like, you know, I remember him, like, going up to Chicago and, like, getting to see them at show that had free kegs and all that. And I'm like, that sounds cool. Like, I don't know. I like Black Dice a lot more because there's stories about them being the shit out of fucking frat boys.
There is also that, yes. That's a
if I'm going to go for, like, weirdo music for guys that, with beards, they're blowing it. But, yeah, I remember photographing Animal Collective, like, 10 years ago and just being like, this is okay.
Yeah. There's so many articles. You, me, and every concert we attend, how to grow older with concerts. This was 2009. He breaks down the eras of when you go to concerts and some of this shit, some of these writings are like, damn, that's fucking real, dog.
Yeah,
because he's,
and then there's the one about what if the bird from the Rat Tat video was also at their shows to like strengthen their brand,
right? So
what if Ratty Tatty
Ratty Tatty, yeah, his obsession with Lana Del Rey,
yeah,
was really something. Well, what really got me was Hipster Runoff Carl's was one of the first to talk about maybe Lana Del Rey is an industry plant.
I mean, just as much as Wet Leg is.
Right, but his
I remember him having articles where he was pondering the question, like, is this a really inauthentic thing? And I actually remember, like, when I covered Lollapalooza, which would coming up on 10 years of that,
yeah,
and talking with other photographers and stuff, and then them being pissed that they had to go photograph Lana Del Rey, who did feel very inauthentic and very put on, like this was something that you would, that this was not something authentic. This was like the thing that you gotta walk past in your way to the grocery store to get to the shit you really want to get to.
Yes.
Because I remember actually a couple photographers who I respect a lot all complained that their editors wanted them to go photograph Lana Del Rey instead of Nine Inch Nails' first show in America in like 5 years.
Right. Which is a valid point.
Yeah, I went and photographed Nine Inch Nails, and it was really weird, but it was awesome.
Right. And now, of course, when I need it the most, the web archive does not have my back here.
Perhaps so, Ratty Tatty pulled the cord.
I think Ratty Tatty did pull the cord.
Yeah,
so,
you know, the last thing I remember about Hipster Runoff was that Sun Chips ran ads for, like, their new eco-friendly bags. Do you remember this?
I do. Yeah.
And I just remembered that, one, that seemed like a really weird thing, and two, I remember the backlash on the bags because they were so fucking loud.
Yes.
Sun Chips mood in that part of my life.
Right.
But I just heard that from people, like, yeah, it's bad. And they're really biodegradable, loud. But like, it fucking sounds like I'm walking through a wind tunnel.
Jesus Christ. The Lana Del Rey bit, he wrote an entire article, Lana Del Rey Exposed, before she was alt, which was another one of his inventions,
yeah.
Alt. She was a failed mainstream artist without fake lips. And it is a very long article with photos of her when she used to go by Lizzie Grant. And just,
yeah,
like, that felt like a real expose. Like, that felt like real journalism. You never knew with Hipster Runoff what the fuck you were going to get.
Yeah, I mean, Buddyhead was the same way, too. You would either get something, like, really thoughtful and, mm-hmm, like, with some real bones behind it. Or you would literally get, like, here's an Olsen Twins phone number. I don't know if it's the one that's on Coke or not, so maybe you should give a call and ask.
Jesus.
You know,
the feud that he started with Donald Glover when it was Childish Gambino first coming out, which was a one-sided feud. Donald Glover really didn't give a shit about him. But, like, yeah, just he was kind of the antidote to
very serious music journalism.
Even like the super frivolous Perez Hilton shit.
Yeah. No, so, it was kind of like what Perez Hilton actually like stood for something.
Yeah. It was so bizarre. Like, he did an entire pictorial about a photo somebody snapped of Alice Glass from Crystal Castles with her skirt up. Like, okay.
Who did, are we talking about?
Carl's.
Oh, okay.
And it was like, all right. So it was like, what do you believe?
Well, are you against the spectacle, or do you feed off of it? Are you a part of it?
Who the fuck knows?
It was all over the place.
You never really knew what the hell was going on. But this was the time, I think a little historical context is important for some of our younger listeners who may not have lived through this period. This was a time where things like the Hype Machine were a big deal. Now, the Hype Machine was basically an aggregator of other music blogs, and they would have links to downloads or whatever that would be on the front page. And there were music blogs by the score. You couldn't, you know, swing a cat without hitting a music blog.
Oh, God, so many. Mm. I remember Music of the Hour.
Music of the Hour, yep.
Which was a local music blog that I think got updated for like 3 months. Like, it was very interesting. They started it, and they got a little bit of smoke blown up their ass by the RFT. And then, like, yeah, everyone had a music blog. I mean, I had one, and now I have one again when I update when I'm, like, not so fucked up from long COVID that I can concentrate on things. Everyone had a fucking music blog 10, 12 years ago.
Right. And this was, Hipster Runoff to me was kind of this is where this was all going. You know what I mean? Like, here's this one person who's the only creator for the site, as far as I know. Again,
sure.
It's all pseudonymous.
Could have been a ghostwriter.
Could have been
here and there.
Could have been a dozen ghosts. Yeah. But what's interesting is that beyond the vapid shit, like, here's an upskirt of Alice Glass, or here's, you know, Lana Del Rey on a cover of something, then it was like really weirdly philosophical posts. Like I said, the one about you and me in every concert we've ever been to, where they're talking about, like, when you're in your 30s, you know, this is the post-college being supportive by your parents era. Concerts are sad reminders of where your life is. Like, it got to the meat of something, like, but it was such a scattershot. You could never really tell where he's going to come
from. Yeah, you could get something like that, or you could get a blog post that was "City is my church" in bold italic, you know,
right,
80 times in a row.
Like an entire article about Vampire Weekend writing a jingle, and about, like, is this the death of culture? But he's not serious, you know? There's kind of like a wink in there. Like, I don't know. There were so many little linguistic, stylistic things that Carl's did that also really amused me. Like, they would say something like, I'm having drinks, and then it would be like, via the bartender. So, like, whatever this...
Right? You know, the bartender at the spin party.
Whatever. You know? So, like, but, you know, via Hipster Vibes with 2 Z's, you know, you never really could pin it down. Like, but there was still, like, anytime he was talking about a cute girl, it was BB, you know, like, Alice Glass, BB, what are you going to do about, you know, people taking pictures of your vagina or whatever? It's
such a weird. I think what I liked about Hipster Runoff was that being a music photographer and being all around that stuff, seeing that, being a part of that part of the industry or the media, you know, being the house photographer, a venue, then being a freelance for, you know, various local and regional, you know, shindigs. I got to see different sides of that, and it was always interesting. Like, it did suck.
Yeah.
Like,
there was a lot to joke about. There was a lot of
like, people, like, you know, I used to joke, you know, there was a local band here called the Brainstems.
Yeah.
And, you know, they were a real gross garage rock band. They played, like, the cheapest fucking instruments, like the fucking Austin Telecasters and shit, which you can get for, like, $100 and some change at, like, you know, a fucking tourist trap on Beale Street.
Yeah.
You know, all that. But they all went to Wash U.
Right.
I used to always joke that they broke up because they all got great jobs at GlaxoSmithKline. You know, and like, I still think Styrofoam, like, I think that's I'll put that on every once in a while and be like, man, they fucking had it.
Yeah.
I think Styrofoam's a great little release. I still have the little cassette tape that has a cover of Thunderbird.
Yes.
And at their record release show, they were passing around bottles of Thunderbird. And you know, I'm like, oh gosh, no wonder why bums drink this. It really does make you forget anything else that's going on because it's so bad.
Yeah, no, it's not
and,
good.
And, you know, I remember going to Handlebar.
Yeah.
Which is like the like hipster bar here in St. Louis, still, I want to say.
Yeah, it's a bar themed around bikes.
Yeah, but like, it was also where the, like, if you worked at Urban Outfitters, that's where, like, you hung out. Yeah. And it was like, you know, lots of jokes about doing coke in the bar, not in the bar, but in the bathrooms at the bar. I think one of my proudest moments was some girl that I had met at Electric Six show.
Yeah.
Texted me and she was like, oh, you should come out to Handlebar. And I was like, I don't know. Well, I was at the Royale because Bruiser Queen were spinning a DJ night.
Great.
And I was like, I don't know, come out over here to the Royale because it's not, you know, like really cool shit's going on, way cooler than whatever's going on handlebar. And like driving into the Grove, because I was hard up for any attention for women at that point. I was definitely a sad, sad man for that like very short period of time that this was going on. And remember like parking in the Grove, walking over to the handlebar, and like realizing it was one of those fucking like night life things where they got some photographer. And I'm like, DJ Clockwork, I know he ties money from this to like his fucking mega church out in Chesterfield. Fuck this.
Yeah.
Heard so many. They did the fucking Indian summer thing. Mm. Like, I'm not. And like, this fucking kid.
Oh, and
like
they had the temerity to call it fucking London Calling.
Yeah. London Calling. That's what that fucking terrible thing was called. And I'm like, I'm not. And this like fucking kid, like, you know, in the fucking Urkel glasses and a bow tie. It's like it's a $15 cover. And I just remember looking at him and go, I would never pay a cover to come into this fucking shit stain. And like I turn around and there's all these people in their nice little perfect hipster outfits, their fucking bands around their forehead or whatever. Mm-hmm. And they just all look terrified at me. This grumpy shithead in a hoodie with a you know, with a fucking plaid shirt underneath and wearing jeans that he got from a fucking thrift store.
Right.
Just being like, no.
Right.
I don't want, you know, and I was like, yeah, I would never pay to go into this fucking place. Are you fucking kidding me?
You're not wrong. I think that's
which and that place is owned by the chick that had the fucking fake communist bar on Cherokee Street.
Yeah.
That had all the fucking Soviet era fucking propaganda and then these cute little cocktail signs that said, this is just for aesthetic reasons only. We don't actually endorse any of the ideas or ideologies being presented here.
Right, because if they did, you'd be out of
Street Fight.
Yeah.
Perform there and we're like, the fuck is this? Like complained about, there's a whole entire episode where they complain about how fucking shitty that their like little performance there was.
Fucking A. I knew Bryan was a stand-up guy. The hipster runoff piece that I always remember though, it's the one that I'm probably going to reference more often than not. It's Carl's has an epiphany about the Beatles.
Vaguely remember this.
He has an epiphany about the Beatles because Pitchfork finally reviewed them.
Oh, that's so good.
I won't even go into the whole like reading it thing, but it's just, I finally feel like the Beatles are relevant to me.
They're a band worth blogging about.
Yes, they are now. This was 2010, you know? So he knew in a really odd way, like what would get eyeballs on a post. Posting about the early days of Lana Del Rey, calling her Princess Lana BB. There was even a great post-mortem on Lana Del Rey's first appearance on Saturday Night Live, which, if you remember, was a disaster.
Yeah.
She barely moved. She was in this like awful-looking dress.
Wasn't there like some weird lights around her
something? It was a whole mess. Right.
I remember one time someone played me like a chopped and screwed version of video games. I'm like, I can't tell the... This song moves at a glacial pace.
That whole record does, yeah.
Jeez, it's a song you play when you can't find barbiturates, but you want the same vibe.
Yeah. So in a postmortem of that Saturday Night Live appearance, he went into this entire diatribe about the attention-based economy, and it really felt like he was pulling back the curtain a little bit. Like, I've just been trying to do this for clicks and, you know, maybe I don't even like Lana Del Rey. Like, just walking back some of his early stuff. Because at a certain point, they even renamed the site the Lana Del Report.
I remember this.
And amazing. Doing, like, daily posts only covering her. And Carl's actually posted about that, you know, saying the opinions that I have on bands are not actually my own. And my goal is to preserve a relationship with readers or bands/artists based on editorial pandering. All I can do is go down in flames with my sweet Princess Lana BB. My demented online personality that motivates me to type these words in order to accumulate hits, empathy, praise, and controversy does not have much time left. And that was 2012. It wasn't wrong.
I mean, he's kind of cutting into something here because so much of music journalism, particularly the blog stuff, was really fucking sucking the corporate dick.
Well, it was also very shallow.
Very shallow.
There wasn't
And people, I mean, I've talked about this, but people hated me that I was contrarian about anything. Like, right. I would be like, I don't think they're being sincere. I think it's, you know, this idea is bullshit. And some, you know, I was usually right. I remember you telling me that was one of the first things you liked about me was that I didn't fucking pull any punches.
No, because that's refreshing. Like, this was, you know, you and I met at a time where Hipster Off was still running.
Yeah.
So, you know, that was about the time where I was getting really fucking tired of, you know, hearing whoever talk
about. I mean, if I really sat here, I could think about, like, local bands that everyone was lining up to fucking gag down their fucking demon. Wasn't there Demon Lover? Wasn't that one of the things?
I actually like Demon Lover.
I saw them once, and they did, like, a weird, like, art house remix of, like, a Nelly song, and then had one of the girls from Dub Nub get on stage, and she didn't know what to do, and I'm like, this is a fucking train wreck.
That might have been an off night, because, I mean, I had seen Demon Lover a couple times. But anyway, that's a matter, again, music being subjective and all.
Sure.
But, like, yeah, why are so-and-so so popular?
I'm going to actually say something about a band that I think is really good. I remember when people thought that fucking Sleepy Kitty was going to cure fucking AIDS.
Yeah.
You know, people, I was like, you know, I thought they were, you know, in their little loft on Cherokee Street, synthesizing materials and being like, you know, if we can get these proteins to bond.
Yeah, well, I mean, a lot of that had to do with the fact that, you know, Evan Salt was in Harvey Danger, and he kind of knew the industry, and he kind of knew what was going on, and Paige is no slouch either, so, like,
sure,
these are people who have been around the block before. It's not like they were brand new.
But there was something weird for a minute where I'm like, they're really fucking good, and they're nice people.
There's a certain limit, I think, you hit where you're doing too much.
Sure.
And so... we're getting into scene politics, but...
But this is related to, because this was kind of... this was a smaller stage extrapolation of a lot of stuff that was being expressed on Hipster Runoff.
That's a fair point. So Carl's apparently invented an entire genre, chill wave. You mentioned it before.
I remember on my old website, I actually had a post that I put up in the summer of 2010 that was, chill wave is not a real genre.
Well, you're not wrong. Yeah.
But I think, like, the lead photo of that was, like, Toro Y Moi or whatever the fuck they were called.
Yeah. And while they're a fun band to see.
They opened up for Caribou.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was at that one. I was at that show.
That was a fun show.
Yeah, it was fun.
I think that was, like, the last time Caribou played St. Louis.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, wouldn't surprise
that
me.
That was that great time of indie bands that, like, were just one word and it was named after an animal. There was, like, Caribou. There was, like, Tortoise.
Yeah. Oh, Tortoise kicks ass.
Yeah, Tortoise kicks ass. I'm not saying any of these bands were bad, but that was just, like, a thing that was going on.
Yeah. Vulture did a piece also called Watching Hipster Runoff Eat Its Own Tail, which is a great headline, and also... a thought that I hadn't had until I read this piece, and I want to definitely give credit to Rob Trump. Folks. Oh. Yeah. Oh. I'm going to give credit to Rob Trump for making the connection between... well, let me just read you his words. I should note that Hipster Runoff was not the first website to mock the self-important stupidity to be found on the internet. Writers at Something Awful had been doing it for years. Even in character as teenage hacksaw Jeff K or grumpy old man Cliff Yablonsky. What set HRO apart from his predecessors was the relatable humanity at the center of it. As insufferable as Carl's was, the more Hipster Runoff you read, the more you sort of loved him, and it didn't hurt that the website's author was pretty clearly incorporating pieces of his own real life into the satire. And that is something, as far as analysis goes, that I hadn't really even...
yeah.
I enjoyed Hipster Runoff purely on a surface level. You know what I mean? Like, I hadn't really gotten to that much thought into it.
For me, it was a little different because, like, I've kind of alluded to here, like, I would read Hipster Runoff and then I would go shoot that night. And be like, oh, this is what's going... like, you know, photographing, like, Lil B or photographing bands no one has thought about in years. Just, you know... Man or something, and like
I really like Man Man, but
they were part of that era. Yeah, Man Man are great. Much love to Man Man. Yeah. But you get what I'm saying. Like, those were very hot bands.
Mr. Heavenly, or whoever.
Mr.
You know.
Fucking Heavenly.
Yeah, Michael Cera's band there.
I remember going in the green room at the Firebird, talking to Nick from Islands, and I remember me and him. I was telling him how I really love the Human Highway project he did a couple years ago with some Guthrie progeny. Mm-hmm. And he was just like really excited that anyone remembered it. But I just remember him talking to me about, and he was holding a massive, like, restaurant size. So there we go. That's the word, jar.
Okay.
Jar is the word I'm looking for here, folks. Really, really racking my brain here.
Scraping the bottom of that barrel, buddy.
Fucking, I'm tapping on the glass and the goldfish is just like not even registering.
Nope.
Goddamn long COVID sucks dick.
Yeah.
Anyways, so he's holding this giant, like, has to be like a fucking gallon-sized jar of like Mount Olive pickles.
Hell yeah.
To his chest. Like, it is... Like, if he drops it, the world is going to end.
He's got a
clutch.
And he's
just like, dude, I'm really, really glad you liked that. And I hopefully we get to do another one someday. I just think it's a solid project. You know, great show tonight. He's just like, just tight to his chest. Oh, man, thanks. I got to get out to the van. I was like, hey, man, safe travels.
It's his, like, emotional security pickles. I don't know.
Emotional security jar pickles.
I can see it, too, because I've seen Nick do a couple shows. Yeah, like, just like... It's painted a picture in my mind. It's so beautiful. But
but like moments like that is like a hipster runoff moment where you're trying to be very sincere with someone, but they're also doing something really weird. And I remember also one time someone having Yingling in the backstage, and I was like, I've never had one before.
Yeah.
I'll give you $5 for one.
Okay.
And them just being like, I'm good. And I'm like, but we can't get that here.
Yeah.
And I've never had it before. Part of my life where, like, I want to drink. I want to drink all the time to quiet the voices.
Yeah.
And I can't remember who it was, but that was a very hipster runoff-y kind of moment, just being like, hey, you have something that's very scarce in this region, and I'm willing to pay you over market value for it. And they're being like, no, I'm sorry. Yeah. You're a plebeian here in the Midwest while I go back to New York, where I moved to from another shithole. I moved to New York City from a shithole like St. Louis.
Right.
I came from Peoria or Sheboygan, Biloxi.
Hackensack. You know,
Jackson, Mississippi. Jackson, Mississippi.
Jackson, Mississippi.
Jackson, Mississippi.
We're really digging on Jackson, Mississippi. Yeah, just get them.
Get their asses.
So a hipster runoff subsite that started showing up is the Alt Report. You remember this?
Brian? Remember the Alt Report?
The Alt Report was even bloggier and even less writing. There would often just be like an image. I think the M83 post was an Alt Report.
Was
post.
It?
Okay.
Yeah.
And then. Carl's decided, I got to play both sides. So he created a character called the Mainstreamer. The Mainstreamer posted in Comic Sans. And it was like, oh, yeah, Kings of Leon's really good or whatever. The Mainstreamer was a little bit more vitriol, though. I felt like the Mainstreamer was definitely Carl's reacting to, like, the hipster runoff audience not getting that this was a joke.
Yeah.
And so it's like, okay, you want a joke? I got a whole fucking, you know, it felt mean almost in the way that Buddyhead was mean.
Yeah.
Mean for a purpose, sure, but still mean. Alt Report and the Mainstreamer were like, oh, link bait. They would figure out what was going to get clicks that day, like, oh, Animal Collective or whatever. And they'd post a link about it, but it would just be like a picture. There would be nothing there. And they were successful in that way, like getting attention. 16 years later, you can see Pitchfork doing that now. So it's one of those things. Like, in Carl's own words from the Vulture article, I have a blog called Hipster Runoff. Every day I wake up, open my laptop, and type words that are stored in the internet as content, his quotes there. My goal is to, quote, get as many hits as possible because I metaphorically, quote, have mouths to feed. I realize that at this point it doesn't matter if my content is, quote, premium, pseudo brilliantly written web_prose or just, quote, link bait wave. I was fortunate enough to have not gotten lost in the long tail of indie music plus Gen Y opinion driven coverage blogs. Every day I prey upon different buzz topics, exploiting my voice, but more importantly, my position as a, quote, recognized outlet, the number 4 buzz, to try to trick people into thinking I am, quote, relevant, which basically just means that I am trying to make people talk about my blog and get them addicted to my web brand. He goes on for another 5 fucking paragraphs, but I'm not going to read the rest of it. But he's being very honest. Like, this is cynical. I'm doing this for clicks.
All the people that were doing it, for real, like to say, doing with a straight face,
yeah,
were being deep down just as cynical.
Right. But they were never going to admit it.
Oh, yeah.
And I think that's part of why blog culture collapsed, is because no one can keep up the facade for that long.
I kind of realized that early on, like when I was writing about my photography and all that on my old website, and kind of just used less text and just posted photos. And like, it's kind of weird going back and like looking, because I'm like kind of reposting some things on my new site, amusicphotography.com. And I remember like I was going through Angel Olsen, the when I photographed her, like I think first performance in St. Louis.
Oh, early days. Yeah.
Yeah. This is like, you know, almost exactly 13 years ago. It was like February 2013. Didn't write a lot, and I thought I had written more when I was like looking through that text, and I wrote like, you know, said some really nice things, and it's really not hard to imagine her becoming something more than she is now. And I was like, huh, yeah, I was right about that.
Yeah,
yeah, she was like playing to like, and she was opening up for a band, Water Liars, who are great, but like haven't really done anything in a while. And like,
yeah,
you know, that was some dudes from Humdrum, I think. And, you know,
they were real buzzy. They had a bit of a buzz. They had the alt babies all.
The alt babies.
Yep.
Throwing their AM-appy leggings on stage. But, like, you know, not a lot, but Angel Olsen, obviously, like, playing big rooms and having a really lovely career. But, like, but there was, like, Andrew W.K. I remember photographing Andrew W.K. and fucking hating it.
Right,
just photos. Didn't write anything. I think I wrote like some text so it would have some SEO.
Right,
it was mostly just like, this show sucked, this crowd sucked. Dudes were trying. I remember all these dudes trying to force drinks on the underage chicks. And I'm like, this sucks. Yeah. And Andrew McKay like wouldn't come out and talk to people. And I'm like, he just hid in the green room, and then he didn't realize that we don't give a shit, so we all just sat outside the green room, trapping him in there. I was like, all right, Keith Kyle, or whatever your fucking name is.
And there's no way out of that green room.
I've spent a lot of time painting that green room. There's no escape, even if you got into the drop ceiling.
There's one way out, and you got to go through people,
Yeah, so that was kind of funny. I remember his tour manager was shitty, Cy Burns, who was also his keyboard player. Like, you guys got to go, and I'm being like, well, we all know, like, the venue owner, and that's one of the venue owner's fiancés, so, like, yeah, this ain't really. Eventually, I think we got bored because we heard there was somewhere that was we could go drink afterwards.
Perfect. I think Hipster Runoff was very indicative of a time and a place, and I think that we, as a culture, have evolved past the need, I guess, because we got a million different Hipster Runoffs on Twitter every day.
What was now scarce is abundant.
Right.
I think, I mean, everyone can be a smarmy, maybe too clever by half person and get 1,000 followers for reposting pig poop balls.
Right.
And saying Jordan Peterson has no dick, and saying that Donald Trump invented Gamergate or something, or Donald Trump was the first guy to demystify Gamergate, or, you know, some weird, like fucking the shit that got Playo fucking done in.
Right. We've gone from Hipster Runoff, which was a niche to begin with, but now, like I said, there's a million of them all on Twitter. And the timing, now I'm thinking about it, 2013, 2014, 2015, that's right around when Twitter was starting to kind of hit that big upswing.
Well, it was really goat seeing the Iranian student revolution with the fake Hoobastank.
Right.
I think that was the first time, my brother's friend was a VP at Twitter. I knew of it. I think like my oldest account's like an 07.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I had one in 2010.
Yeah. It took me a while. So I knew about it and didn't really fuck with it because I didn't understand it. And then when, as a music photographer, like Twitter was a really great way of getting my stuff out there. I was really late to Instagram because I thought it was kind of, I thought Instagram was lame, still do. Didn't really get on Instagram until like 2013. And I think really for me, what validated Twitter like as a real, like a town square or something, was Ferguson.
Yeah.
So that was almost 10 years ago.
Yeah.
And like, oddly enough, like Twitter and Vine were probably the two social platforms that did the best job of getting that information out there, like what was going on like West Florissant, what was going on like culturally, locally in St. Louis. You know, it was a nice, flip from you know, the weird Twitter drill talking about logging off. And
right.
I mean, it was really, it really was kind of just like people trying to weenie tap each other on the internet for years. And then Ferguson happened, and I think it became like a really more legitimate thing. Oh, did you see that someone was going through DeRay's tweets and seeing all retweeting all the times that he mentioned Excel?
No.
dude was really, really in love with Excel for a while. It's
I mean, I guess that's a, everyone has a phase, right?
everyone. Yeah, I was really, you know, my first office job, I was really Excel curious.
I got introduced by an older office worker, you know.
Into Excel. who told you could do dates like this? An older coworker told me to do it, sir. I'm sorry, sir. Yep. I'll never do it again, sir.
Exactly. Well, Bryan, are you ready?
Oh, I'm always ready for some gross shit.
And now, the moment you've all been waiting for. Shock.jpg.
This goes by the name of Fukuona Shouju 03, translating to Unfortunate Girl 03 in Japanese.
Japan.
Created by VV Indos Me, so Windows Me. Posted on Pixiv May of 2012. 4chan, of course, big on this because it intersected with a lot of their interests. Are you familiar with this?
I'm not. I mean, I'm familiar with like these long form GIFs.
Mm-hmm. Well, this one in particular, particularly disturbing. It is very well animated. I will give you this, and it is a.
Huh. Her clothes are gone.
Her clothes are gone, and now so is her skin.
Oh. Well, that's like degloving a hot dog.
Yes.
But it's
very distressing.
I'm much further away from the monitor than you, so it's just kind of like, oh, that's gross and bad.
Yeah, it includes.
Unfortunately, there's no factor to this.
There is no sound. There is no. It's just strictly a looping GIF of a young anime girl getting hit by lasers and then it pulling her skin off, which includes the butthole trailing her intestine behind her.
What a nice little detail.
Yes, it's. Extremely graphic, very bizarre. Why the fuck this exists, I still don't understand. But like,
I mean, the internet.
I know, but come on.
I know that can't be the answer for everything, but it's just like, yeah. I mean, that's pretty jacked up.
Yeah, I mean, the GIF ends with her vomiting and dying.
Huh. Like all great works of art.
Like all, yeah, well, God, if only Lydia Tarr had vomited and died at the end of Tarr, that would have been a good movie. But, right? No?
Okay. Yeah, I haven't seen Tarr yet.
Okay, I haven't seen Tarr yet.
So, what streaming services is it on?
Good question. I do not know. I got it from a friend's Plex.
Oh.
So, yeah, there's a lot of comments underneath this one saying, you know, I was 13 when I saw this and I will never forgive the internet for it. Sometimes you can even, you know, trigger someone who's seen it before with just the still image, you know, and they're like, no, please, God, don't show me this again. It definitely appeared a lot on 4chan. This was one of the ones that made me really stop and consider if I'm ever going to expand a link again on a 4chan thread, because it was used a lot. It was used a lot. You know, there's no warning of what's coming. It's weird. You know, it's a anime girl in a machine, but you don't know what the machine's going to do. And at first it's like, oh, there are her clothes. Like you said, oh, her clothes are stripped off, but then it's like, oh, but that's also her skin. So gross. So yes, beautiful girl, or no? What was the? Now I lost.
Unlucky
it.
Girl or something?
It was unfortunate girl. Excuse me. 03. Mm-hmm. So apparently this was not the first or the last. The unfortunate girl series. I am not interested in finding out what else. Yeah, there. Another comment here. There's like five or six of them in total. Even one where she's eating ice cream. So kind of wish I'd seen that one instead.
But the ice cream is piss.
Oh, no.
Oh, no. It's doo-doo. It's doo-doo pee-pee.
Doo-doo.
Oh, no. Jason, I told you.
No more doo-doo.
No more pee-pee poo-poo.
Nope. So yeah, that's that. It's time for the breath mint, because boy, I need one. Yee, baby.
Yeah, they gave up. The new MS Paint record is out.
Okay.
Post-American. It came out last Friday on the 10th.
Mm.
I got to spend some time with it. I think it is really fucking good. I think the guy from Military Gun, which is a very hyped band at this moment, produced it. And what's interesting about it is that they went and re-recorded some of the songs that were on their EP
mm-hmm.
that came out in 2020, the self-titled EP.
Yeah.
And it's a mixed bag on those. I think it was smart to do, if they're going to include those songs, to record them with the current production values.
Right.
But there was some mix and production choices and some aesthetic choices I don't necessarily agree with for those songs in particular. The original EP kind of has like a lo-fi, a little bit of crunch to it, and a little it comes off a little amateur in a way that's not bad. That's actually like really like, this is exciting.
Kind of like feels like a punk record almost. Yeah.
Well, it's that they're trying something different, and there's an energy here that's really nice. And the new versions of songs like Post American or Hardwired, they kind of lost a little something. And the selection of tracks that create this record, it makes sense.
Okay.
There's some new songs on there. Titan of Hope, I've talked about, is a fucking banger. Free from the Sun might be the best record or best song on the record. I've really enjoyed it, and I hope that, you know, when they get around to recording their second record, it's just as good, if not better. They got a 7.4 on Pitchfork,
hey.
which is, God, it's when you get into the sixes, is that when Pitchfork is literally trying to kill you.
They got blog buzz, baby.
Yeah. Well, it's just like, you know, if it's a, because most stuff is at least a 7 on Pitchfork, so if you get below that, the 6 seems to be the death zone.
Yeah.
If you get like a 4 or 5, then it's just, you just, you know, maybe people will still give you a shot, but no one wants to spend their time for a 6.
No. Well, Alkaline Trio, one of their early records, got like a 1.
Yeah.
But that fucking reviewer has since recanted and be like, no, this album was actually like an 8.5. So.
Fucking nerd.
I know.
Fucking want to throw his iPad in the fucking mud. I'm telling you. On it.
Just get him out of here.
Get him out of here. So that's great. Go listen to Post American. It's really awesome. I have been really enjoying the hell out of it. I've been I've been listening to anything else new. I've been kind of fucking boring and lazy. Fucking Last of Us finished.
Yep. And I just started it. So well, like I told you, I wait for a series to end, and then I'll start it from the top. And I'm 2 episodes in, and I'm really enjoying it. I'm really sad that Anna Torv had to leave. But I know I played the game. I know Tess has to be one of the first main characters to kind of really bite it. So it wasn't a surprise, but it was very effective the way it happened. I'm very excited to see how the rest of it plays out, because I really liked how everything was done in a way that's familiar, but it's still new. That was neat to me. I think
they did a very good job being true to the source material, but also expanding on what you can do with it in a different medium.
Yeah, definitely.
It kind of loses a little bit of steam near the end, but I feel like the story in the game does too.
Right.
I think when you get to David the Cannibal, it kind of loses its...
There's peaks and valleys. Yeah,
it loses itself for a second. And the final episode is actually, I think, the shortest one the entire season. It's like 45 minutes.
Yeah, somebody mentioned it feeling rushed.
Very rushed.
Huh.
It was neat. Like, and it did some stuff I really liked. And Pedro Pascal really threw down some acting chops in this episode. And I mean, the ending hits just as hard when Ellie says okay. Mm-hmm. And, you know, my poor girlfriend doesn't know what happens in the second game. I remember my girlfriend saying something like, I hope Ellie doesn't end up and do bad things. And I'm
Well,
you
don't want to spoil it, but you also want to soften the blow a bit, I guess.
Yeah, I was like, well, in the second game, some really rough stuff. But you can meet Dina, and Dina's a fantastic character.
Dina's great, yep. You see more of Tommy. I love Tommy.
Everything about the second game is recontextualizing what happened in the first from different viewpoints. And I think it's a fantastic story. I understand there's some dissonance between like how violent the gameplay is and then how emotional and how much pathos are in like the cutscenes and the actual story.
Which is, I think, why it works for television in a way that it maybe didn't in the gameplay. Because there's no dissonance. It's
as violent as it needs to be for the show. Right. And there's definitely some good violence if you're looking for some blood on the screen.
Oh, God, that first episode where Joel beats the Fedra guy to death with his bare hands and breaks his knuckle.
I'm amazed how they were able to cover so much in that first episode and not make it feel rushed.
No, it definitely, the pace was right on. At least in those first couple. Again, I still haven't
got... It's really good front to back. Yeah. I really enjoyed it. But yeah, I'm really waiting for them for the second season. I'm waiting for them to tackle because...
Yeah, part two is harrowing.
Yeah, and I told my girlfriend, like, hey, I have part two on my PlayStation. We can play it together and you can see what's coming. And she's like, I kind of want to like not know. And I'm like, okay, it's fair.
That's like not reading ahead in the Walking Dead comics. I think there are different experiences.
Yeah. Still getting through the first season of Succession.
Okay.
Have
you found the MacGuffin or the bit you were looking for?
There's just some really terrible people.
Yeah, yeah.
Have you watched it?
I've watched the first couple episodes and I kind of dropped off. I think something else came up and I was like, well, I'll watch this later.
The character Tom, the guy who plays him, whose name escapes me at this moment, really just has like the intensity of Kevin Spacey nailed down.
Okay.
And it's like if this is like what John Doe from Seven was doing before he decided to kill people.
Okay. Siobhan's husband.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, he's a fucking maniac.
Yeah.
And me and my girlfriend just been saying, "You trying to fuck me, pig man?" over and over.
Oh, yeah. Matthew McFadden, the guy who plays.
Okay.
Yeah. Real. Because from what I remember, yeah, he's a real, real dick. And yeah. It's great.
It's really interesting. And just like watching people behave badly and also thinking that Logan might still be like the most reasonable person in the whole entire family,
which is baffling but also entirely possible.
Yeah.
Which I think is the main tension of the show, that and you know, Roy, or what is it Roy, what's the
his brother?
Yeah
I think his brother's Roy.
Yeah.
cousin Craig's grandpa.
Yes. That's one I really do want to get back into, because I love Brian Cox as the patriarch of that family. He's just grumpy in all the best ways. Yeah, he sells it.
Yeah, amazing performance from him. Like he really can make it look like there's no light behind those eyes when he's going through his health troubles. And like, you know, it was a little tough for me because it reminded me how my grandfather was near the end of his life. Yeah. And I was like, wow, he really fucking nailed it, like in an upsetting way.
Yeah, there definitely is a verisimilitude to the way the show is not only shot, but like the way that all the characters kind of are portrayed. Even the Calkin kid.
Yeah.
He's the Roman. Thank you. He's the slimy prick, but he does it so well. And I feel like, yeah, I kind of know that guy. I know there's guys like that. Like I went to high school with a couple of those guys. I went to high school with a couple of Romans. You know,
you might be doing a podcast with one.
Hey,
yo, my dick also doesn't work.
Well, I mean, yeah, it's what the meds are for.
What meds?
I don't know.
Doctors are holding out.
They said
he was too powerful when his dick worked.
Uh oh.
We have to power cap him.
I got no follow-up.
He was too powerful
to that
when he could shoot white ropes. by just thinking about a Brio he had once.
You're doing the Charles Xavier thing with two fingers at your head and you're just shooting.
Just the most pathetic spray. One pump out. Yeah. It looks like someone was trying to get the very little bit of ranch dressing out of the wishbone bowl. It's just a little spurt. Pathetic. There's not even... Can you even taste it if you were put it in your mouth? And now our 40 listeners are wondering, like, so does his dick really not work or does it work? Because I was talking about just jacking off willy-nilly at the movie theater.
Right.
That's not coconut oil.
No. Listeners, it's a mystery. You'll have to...
Only a few select know the providence of my boyfriend dick. it doesn't happen a lot, but sometimes I just start saying things and I'm like, I'm not gonna like what
nope.
comes out at the end.
But you can't take it back now. It's already coming out.
All right. No. Yep. Oh, that's a sad phrase.
So I enjoyed over this past weekend not the Oscars themselves, but the On Cinema at the Cinema 10th Annual Oscar Special.
Ooh.
A 3.5-hour brutal, brutal comedy exegesis from Tim Heidecker and Greg Turkington. So throughout season 13 of On Cinema, there has been a singular tension, and it started early on, where the Tim Heidecker character, again, Tim and Greg are playing fictionalized versions of themselves. The Tim Heidecker character borrowed Greg's VFA van, the VFA being the Victorville Film Archive, Victorville, small city in California, the Victorville Film Archive van that they were going to take around to all these different filming locations in California. Well, Tim borrows the van to take his awful band Dakar out on tour. They get about 3 days into the tour, but the Victorville Film Archive van is a modified van where it has no roof so that people can look out the side, much like you would expect to see in a real Maps of the Stars type of thing where you're going around in California. So because it has no roof, their gear got stolen, and they're having a real shitty tour. It's like 2 dates into the tour, and there's this terrible car accident. One of the band members is blinded. Tim loses all his teeth, and so he has to have these fake ones in for the whole rest of the season. It's physical comedy. It's deep lore going back 10 years in this show, and it all culminates every year with the Oscar special. You know, on this one, you know, Tim is being very deferential to Greg and calling him the king of movies and all this stuff. But eventually, by the end of the 3 hours of awkward, painful moments of just, it's a masterclass every year of sustained tension and release. And I think this one is probably up there in the highlight reel. Like, they've done 10 of these, and it's live every year. They do 4 hours, and it's, you never know what's going to happen. I don't think half the cast knows what's going to happen, except for Tim and Greg, because they have kind of an idea, like, okay, this is what we're going to do.
This is how it's paced out,
It is probably one of the more interesting pieces, but the problem is you have to, if you've never seen it, you have to go back to a podcast that was started as a goof by Tim and Greg, and they established these characters very early on, that the Tim character knows nothing about movies, and the Greg characters knows too much about movies to the point where he's annoying people with saying, like, how long a movie is. Oh, a runtime of 97 minutes. The minutiae that nobody gives a shit about. Ugh. It's definitely an experience, but the problem is, like I said, there's a lot of material to cover. There is a nice website called the On Cinema Timeline where you can watch everything up until they left Adult Swim and they went out on their own, which has been about 3 years now. So you can watch up to season 10 on the web for free via YouTube, just to kind of catch up and get an idea of what's going on. Seasons 11, 12, and 13 have been on the High Network, H-E-I. That's the first three letters of Heidecker. They created their own streaming Yeah. It's an entire universe to get invested in, because not only is there On Cinema, there's also a sub-series called Decker, where...
Yes, I'm aware of Decker.
Okay. Well, Decker was the creation of the Tim Heidecker character trying to do his own version of, like, a Burn Notice, but with, like, really awful effects and terrible acting. Joe Estevez is in it. It's something to behold every year, and this year is no exception. There's just this perfect moment at the end. And again, some of this without context is not going to make any sense, but he's been shown footage of himself intentionally crashing this van, and he's having an emotional breakdown in Pinocchio makeup. He's trying to tear the Pinocchio nose off, crying. Like, I don't want this. I don't want this. And then, out of nowhere, Brendan Fraser is just one best actor. It's just shit like that just punctures the moment. It's so perfect. It just, I cannot recommend it enough. I'm a big fan of that stuff. And then the other thing that I have been enjoying is obviously The Last of Us. We talked about that. But then there's a book that I started with Mark Danielewski, the writer of House of Leaves, the book Only Revolutions. Bryan, you have opinions about Danielewski. What's up?
In my younger years, going back to the hipster runoff days, courting a young woman who had the logo as a chess piece.
The House of Leaves logo?
Only Revolutions. And then, like, above her waistline, she's a very skinny girl, had Show Your Bones and, like, horror movie font. Well, there's, like, one that has, like, two circles.
Yes, that's it's on the back.
On the back of the book. And I just remember just thinking, like, this is before I'd seen, like, a bunch of bad, easily regrettable tattoos. I remember thinking, like, ooh, that's not going to age well.
And I definitely think getting a House of Leaves or an Only Revolutions or the familiar tattoo is definitely a regrettable decision. I still think the way he plays with form and the way he kind of makes you recontextualize reading is at least interesting.
Sure.
Because Only Revolutions' whole bit is that there are two... There's a front side and a back side to the book. And you have to be switching between them to kind of follow the story in a more logical way. He was doing for straight prose what, like, Chris Ware was doing for comics.
Yeah.
He's experimenting and doing stuff with formalism and doing, you know, some stuff. I've liked a lot of his work. I think The Familiar is 7 fucking volumes of that, and it's a little too much. I could not finish that, but, you know, House of Leaves, this, Thousand Year Knife, there have been a lot.
Has he done other shit since Only Revolutions? Because I feel like the last, maybe. Oh,
yeah. he's done a several books.
I remember, like, a time, like, 2006 or 2007, where me and all of my friends were reading House of Leaves at the same time.
Yeah.
And it felt very on trend.
Yeah. Well, let's see here. He did an art exhibition called Throne. He was working on, let's see here, Only Revolutions, 50 Year Sword. I said Thousand Year Sword. I don't know what the fuck I was saying. 50 Year Sword. Which was a bit of a novella, as like an adult ghost story. But yeah, he's done a few things. But The Familiar has been taking up a lot of his time recently. And The Familiar is originally supposed to be a 27-volume project. I have the first 6 volumes of them. I still have not finished volume 1 because it's dense. It's these gigantic volumes.
I'm good.
Yeah. I think still House of Leaves, probably his best work. I mean, if you're just putting it out there, that's probably going to be...
If there was one thing by the man I would suggest reading, it's probably that. Absolutely. And I feel like there's some asterisks on there, but...
What would that be?
It does fall apart near the end. I found...
Yeah, but I feel like that's by design.
Big spoilers here. Skip like a minute ahead.
Yep.
I felt the part where I like sat and read almost... probably a third of it. I mean, you know, not every page is a full text, but I sat like on a couch and read like a fucking shit ton of it in one sitting. And then I got to the part where the house sucked up, the
The brother.
The brother in the wheelchair. Mm-hmm. And there was something about where I'm like, huh, yeah, this doesn't work for me. Put it down, never read a single page after that.
Okay.
Well, like, it was like a full stop. There was no, like, I did not come. It was like, I'm done. Like, there was something, like, that felt really easy. Didn't feel clever like anything else that had come before. Mm. And I was like, there's something about this that does not resonate in a way that turned me off, that, like, it has become a... you go back to someone's house and they have Ayn Rand or nightstand, don't fuck them.
Yeah,
I feel that way about House of Leaves, and okay. I have definitely gone like, oh, I'm my tum-tum hurt.
I got stuff to do. It does go on for a while past that, and there's more to it. Davidson does survive that moment, but anyway, it's a.
Everything up until that point, I was enthralled. It had its hooks in me. Yeah. Something about that was like, oh, I'm back in reality, and I'm going to go outside and stare at the sun.
Okay. Well, to each their own. Yeah. I definitely thought it was a weak point, but it wasn't necessarily enough to stop me.
I literally did. I definitely pulled an Xbox 360 and walked away.
You turned 360 degrees and walked away. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, that's. I get that. That's for sure. But then that and
I'm a guy that like was fucking reading Samuel Beckett in high school. So if you want to talk about dense, impenetrable like prose, like I had a full heaping of it in my teenage years, reading Malloy and the unnamed, Watt and all that. So I was well versed in people high off their own farts writing words,
right. Yeah, there's even a bit near the end where Daniel Lewski becomes a character in his own story, which, brief, thankfully. But the appendixes that they added in newer editions that had the poems that Johnny Zampano's mom wrote, that was kind of neat stuff. And there's a lot to like about the book. Like you said, the first half especially, very enthralling. But Only Revolutions hasn't quite got the hooks in just yet. But again, I'm still super early on. I haven't really gotten to the meat of the book. So, but it's a lot smaller. It's a lot smaller than A House of Leaves. Well, that about does it for the program, as far as I can tell, Bryan.
I think we've put this baby to bed.
Indeed, we should
smother it and blame it on the neighbor's pit bull.
That said, where can people find you online, Bryan?
If you're looking to frame your neighbor's pit bull for killing a child, you can
can't even make it through that one. Okay.
Listen,
yeah.
If you're tired of that dog barking all night, I got a solution for you. You can reach me at ishotgidibord. That's ishotgidibord on Instagram and ye old Twitter. If you want to check out my photography portfolio, it's assholemusicphotographer.com. If you want to see my barely updated music blog, what has music photos of people performing with their mouth open, that's amusicphotographer.com. Jason, where can they harass you?
You can find me on Twitter and various other places at videocrime, videocrime. You can find me on Instagram and TikTok as @LaserGooseCEO. You can also find the show itself on TikTok and various other places at 48 Minutes of Dogs. That includes Twitter, etc. You can also shoot us an email, 48 Minutes of Dogs Barking @gmail.com. And you can shoot us a text, give us a call. That's our phone number, 314 AHOY POO. Or if you like to spell with your telephone, that's 314-246-9766. Well, Bryan, we're going to leave you with a little bit of music, as we always do. This band's called Ovlov. Are you familiar with them?
I'm not.
This band's called Ovlov. Really dig this track. It's called Really Bees. And it's just a nice little slice of early 2000s. I don't know what you'd even call that, but it's a fun one. I had a lot of good times with it. From their record, Am... I don't know why I started playing that, but anyway, we're gonna leave you, as we always do, with our stern warning and our promise. Namaste, and good luck.
Bye-bye.